And Sheriff Richard Mack is in the studio with us, former Arizona sheriff in Graham County. He's a member of the board of directors of the Oath Keepers movement, oathkeepers.org, and he's with the Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association. The website for that is cspoa.org. You can tweet him at Sheriff Mack. And Sheriff Mack, great to see you.
And if any of your listeners want to email me, just email me at sheriffmack@hotmail.com.
Okay.
Go ahead. Respond all you want. And we want every one of your listeners to become a member of CSPOA. Just do that at cspoa.org.
So you don't have to be a police officer to join?
No, anybody can join.
Okay. All right. I was going off on a lot of things in the last segment. You
were getting me
here.
Wild.
I know. You're sitting here going, okay, I want to talk about this. Is it big government, bad government, small government?
Wait a minute. And I got to go back to DeFazio.
Sure.
Okay. Come on. I mean, this whole game about, oh, the Democrats are good and the Republicans are bad. And, you know, I will admit I'm a registered Republican, but I assail Republicans and Democrats alike. And the reason that Washington, D.C. is so corrupt and ineffective is because both major parties do exactly what you are complaining about the Republicans. Your listeners, same thing, the callers that call in. Come on, quit playing the game of, oh, the Democrats are a little bit better than the Republicans, so we like them, and they're not as corrupt. And
This is the problem.
It is
for every dollar that a corporation or a billionaire invests in our government, they get $760 back.
On both sides.
On both sides.
And
I agree.
And Tom, this is the other thing.
And this came from the Supreme Court. And it's a clear violation of their—
They're corrupt, too.
They are the cancer at the core of the whole damn thing. Yeah. Article 3, Section 2 of the United States Constitution says that the Supreme Court shall be limited in two ways. They shall operate under regulation of Congress.
Right.
Regulation.
Right.
And secondly, that let me actually find it here.
And another one, they're not allowed to make law. The Supreme Court cannot make laws.
Here it is. The Supreme Court shall have appellate jurisdiction both as to laws and to fact, with such exceptions and under such regulations as Congress shall make.
Yeah.
So Congress passes a law.
That's the check and balance.
Right. Congress passes a law that says billionaires can't buy politicians.
Mm-hmm.
John McCain championed this. McCain-Feingold. Right. They pass a law saying we're going to stop billionaires from buying politicians. The Supreme Court says, no, we're going to ignore that. We're going to blow that law up. Where'd they get that right? I mean, I've had Phyllis Schlafly on this show. Once or twice a year, she drops by. I've known Phyllis for years. And, you know, she always goes back to Roe v. Wade. You know, that was an abomination. The Supreme Court made law. Yes, I totally agree. It should not have been done that way.
Right.
Similarly, Citizens United, the Supreme Court should not be doing that. Right. They have, and Buckley versus Vallejo, they shouldn't have done it. They are writing law, and the laws that they're writing are laws that hand power over to very wealthy, very powerful interests. And whether that's a union or whether that's, a couple of oil billionaires, it bothers me. It concerns me.
I will tell you one time the Supreme Court got it right.
What was that?
In my case.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
And I want everybody to remember that. I'm the only sheriff in history to sue the federal government and win a landmark decision. And what Scalia wrote the decision, and a lot of times I don't like Scalia either, but what Scalia did is he just did a history lesson and he enforced the Constitution, which is what the Supreme Court is supposed to do. They have to comply with the Constitution, whether they like it or not.
Right.
And so does the president. Of course, you know, he's not going to either, but Congress will not comply with the Constitution. The White House will not comply with the Constitution. And that's the reason we're in such a huge mess today.
So what part of the Constitution do you think that is not being complied with or needs to be enforced? Here is the Constitution itself.
Well, we could start with the First Amendment and go through all five principles of that one. They do not respect freedom of speech. They do not respect—
How?
How about at the Bundy Ranch and other places when there's protesters, they say you can protest as long as you do it in this corral that we made over here.
Right.
You can wave your signs only in that 25-foot corral.
I agree with you.
Tom.
Free speech.
A corral.
Free speech zones.
Wherever my feet are.
No, I'm with you. You know, free speech zones go back to the Reagan administration, only they got really big during the Clinton administration, and they got huge during the George W. Bush administration. And I agree, they are totally unconstitutional.
And this excuse that other presidents did it or other Republicans did it, so it's okay for Obama to do it,
right?
I don't buy any of that. My mom used to spank me or put me in a corner if I ever said, well, everybody else is doing it.
Right. It's no excuse.
And it's absolutely, it's stupid and it's immature and it's wrong. And so for all the Democrats that come out with these excuses, oh, well, the founding fathers are a bunch of white guys and they hated women and they were racist and, you know, they had no vision. And for them to believe in the Second Amendment, well, that was for muskets and, you know, all of that stupidity like that. People who don't read and understand what the founding fathers said about the Second Amendment. And you asked about what parts of the Constitution aren't being followed. You can just go down the Bill of Rights. Every principle, freedom of religion. They don't care about that. The IRS.
You're right. They're trying to impose religion on us.
They are.
Yeah.
And
this is a Christian country.
And,
what?
And,
really?
Yeah, but
I never heard.
But you have Democrats doing just the opposite. Obama is saying this is not a Christian nation. You know, he's done just
we were
the
not
opposite.
Founded as a, we were not founded as a theocracy. We were not founded as a
no,
Christian
as
nation.
As a theocracy, no.
But George Washington and Thomas Jefferson ridiculed
yes.
the idea.
But on Christian principles, yes.
No, that's not true. We were founded on the principles of the Enlightenment. John Locke and Jean-Jacques Rousseau were the founders of this country far more than Jesus Christ.
Well, if you read,
in fact, Jesus said, you know,
Washington's
render unto Caesar what is Caesar's. Not
well, that doesn't mean everything that Caesar asked for. We have to just bow down and give it to him because this is not supposed to be an oligarchy. It is not a king, even though Obama thinks he is. But this is the whole issue. If you go down the list and you ask what parts of the Constitution, what parts do they hold sacred? None. And so, okay, the first part of the whole thing is Congress shall make no law. Then why is it required for a church to be a 501c3? Or you're not tax exempt unless you bow down to the IRS?
But wait a second.
Why?
Wait a second. No, you're asking the question backwards. Why should you and I be subsidizing a church?
Well, if I pay tithing, that's my choice.
Right, but why should you and I be forced to subsidize a church? Because when a church is a nonprofit,
then why should I be forced to subsidize abortion? Which
well,
I totally abhor.
I don't know any abortion clinics. Well, maybe they're run as
they
nonprofits.
They get money
if they're
from
run as,
the federal government.
If they're run as nonprofits, then, you know, have at it. Turn them into for-profit organizations. I don't have a problem with that. My
but
point
don't
is
force
that,
me through my taxes to pay for them.
But when somebody claims nonprofit status,
I don't
we
care.
Are subsidizing. No, you do care because it's coming out of your tax dollars. Somebody has to pay for their police service. Somebody has to pay for their fire
they
service.
They should pay for it.
But that's called taxes.
Well,
when they're tax exempt, they don't pay for it.
Well,
you and I do. You and I are paying for the roads in front of every church in this country. We're paying for maintaining
the church
has
a right to a road, just like any other citizen or group does.
And we all pay taxes for that, right?
Well, that a public service as far as roads, gasoline tax pays for those. We all pay for that equally.
I am, you know, to the extent that I support religion,
but I'm still
and
going
I do.
Down the list that you
okay.
asked.
All right.
Freedom of religion is not respected by Congress or the White House. Either way, forcing me to believe something or forcing me to pay for abortions or
right.
or forcing me to be 501c3,
right.
forcing churches to be 501c3, Congress shall make no law.
Respecting an establishment of religion.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They have to stay completely out. They cannot intermeddle with the principles of religion, period. They can't get involved.
I agree.
Okay. Then freedom of speech. No, as long as we do it how they say, they grant me a place to do freedom of speech.
I'm with
how
you.
About freedom of the press? Who in the media has got behind and supported Sherry, what's her name, Atkinson from CBS News, who was the one who broke Fast and Furious?
Yeah.
She's been attacked. She's had her computers hacked. She's been monitored by the government.
There is no independent media in this country, Richard.
But independence is one thing, but going after somebody who exposed the president and the Justice Department in supporting Fast and Furious, running guns down to Mexico. Do you know how many people were killed with those guns that went down to Mexico?
Yeah, no,
over 400 Mexicans.
When the Bush administration started
Americans.
That program, they made a big mistake.
Yeah.
I'm with you.
Yeah.
I mean, it never should have done it.
And
the Obama administration shouldn't have continued it.
That's
it
right.
It was a disaster. Sheriff Richard Mack with us. The website is CSPOA, as in Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association. And yes, membership is open to you, too. So, Sheriff Mack, thanks for dropping by.
Hey, thank you.
Great talking to you. We'll be back 15 minutes past the hour.
This is the Tom Hartman Program.
Or take the calls. Thank you for dropping by. Oh, we'll be right back. Stick around. 15 minutes past the hour. Welcome back. Tom Hartman here with you and Randall watching Free Speech TV on the Dish Network in Oceanside, California. You are on the air, Randall.
Yes, Tom, I want to backtrack a little bit here today and talk about your topic yesterday, pardoning Bush and Cheney.
Right. Yeah, I'm of the opinion that Bush and Cheney should be pardoned for torture, for the war crimes.
Yeah. First off is you can
Did you say no way, Richard Sharpe? Arrest them. Yeah, I'm in favor of arresting them, but it's not going to happen. So if you pardon them, then you're labeling them as criminals.
No, you don't understand.
Yeah.
You cannot pardon them because it's a violation of the Constitution, Section 2, under presidential powers.
Because this is an impeachable offense?
Yes, sir.
Well, you know, the Congress has to determine what's an impeachable offense. Impeachable offenses are only defined as high crimes and misdemeanors. So...
You don't think this qualifies as a high crime? I mean, to think about the fact that this...
I think it does. You may think it does.
But to think that this was established during George Washington...
You want to come back on? Sheriff Mack, you want to come back on? Let's hang out for a while and talk about this. Keep going, Randall. Keep talking. Richard Mack is listening, too.
Okay, because it just seems to me that this is such an egregious... At the time it was happening, I was offended as an American. And my president does represent me. And I want him to be held accountable.
Right.
And not just through a pardon, a slap on the wrist, in court.
Yeah. Sheriff Mack, your thoughts on that?
We did torture and we're excusing it because we are claiming that we saved lives.
Right.
Oh, that's the only thing to justify breaking the law. If you can break any law and save lives, if
it just saves
one life, yeah, killing for peace, that we would take America to that low level. Yeah. What makes us any different than the people who do torture in the Middle East or anyplace else?
It's like having sex to promote virginity.
Our cause is more justified than theirs is. And that we lower ourselves to that level, never. Not for my family and not for your family do we submit and lower ourselves to torturing any other human being ever. And then try to justify it that, oh, we saved lives. We were successful. That to me is absolute beyond feeling and beyond forgivable. And I think anybody involved in it, as I yelled out to you from the other room, should be held accountable criminally for it. I don't care if it's Bush or Cheney or Obama. I don't care. Yes, Obama should have known that this was happening, and he should have stood against it, and he should have stopped it way before now.
Well, apparently it was stopped in 2006, but it's, you know, and Obama issued an executive order in his first day in office, officially ending the program. But
one other point. The CIA,
thank you, Randall.
The CIA is out of control. They don't answer to anybody, and there is no oversight that really controls what they do. Not because the president said this is over in 2006. It didn't mean anything to them. Yeah. This agency answers unto themselves. They're almost as bad as the IRS. They do whatever they want, and they are accountable to no one.
It seems. And by the way, not just the CIA. Now it's the NSA. They're building this giant facility out in Utah. I mean, you know.
It's there. I've seen it.
The instruments, the mechanism of state oppression is in place. We just haven't had a president who's pulled the trigger. All hysteria aside, I don't think Obama cared in state oppression. But we can continue that conversation in just a second. 20 minutes past the hour. Sheriff Richard Mack with us and your calls as well. We'll be back. Welcome back. Tom Hartman here with you. I just dragged Sheriff Richard Mack back into the chair here, former Arizona Sheriff of Graham County, Director of Board of Directors of Oath Keepers, and he's with the Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association, CSPOA, and you just went off on torture.
Yes.
Now, we got Dick Cheney, you know, if it's Sunday, it's Meet the Republicans, right, on NBC. They're going to have to meet, they call it Meet the Press, but it's funny. When Bush and Cheney were in power, they said, we have more Republicans as guests because they have power. Now, then you get President Obama in, and they say, we have more Republicans as guests because they're the opposition. But in any case, Dick Cheney is going to be on that show on Sunday telling us how wonderful everything is. And that I think this is all about securing the legacy of Bush and Cheney.
Well, I think that they've had Nancy Pelosi on there so much, and I find her so totally entertaining. I laugh so much every time she opens her mouth.
Yeah. And, but let's get back to torture.
You're right, and we should. And America should never be involved in any of this.
Right.
And whoever is should be investigated, but who's going to control those investigations? Yeah, I mean, they reinvestigated the fiasco and murders at Waco, and it was another whitewash. And they even proved and showed that the FBI had hidden and evidence and obstructed justice. Yeah. And no one ever got in trouble. No one ever gets in trouble. 1,100 IRS agents have recently been found to be cheating on their taxes. What happened to them? They got bonuses. Every single one of them got bonuses. And yet Nancy Pelosi says that we can't cut any money anywhere out of the federal budget.
Well, they're cutting the IRS budget substantially today.
Well, I wish they would. They should abolish the IRS.
Well, yeah. So then how are we going to pay for our army?
Oh, no. We need the IRS. How would we ever pay our taxes?
Seriously. How are you going to pay for an army?
Not having a strong-arm Gestapo-like organization to come out and collect taxes is not meaning that we still aren't going to pay some taxes
how do you
in
do
this
it?
Country.
You want to go to a consumption tax?
You make a fair and simple tax that isn't so convoluted that not even IRS agents can follow it.
Yeah.
You have a simple, fair tax that is the same for everybody in the country, including corporations, just a graduating, simple percentage.
But you want
for
a progressive
everybody.
Tax. You want it to go up as income
well,
goes up, as Thomas Jefferson
suggested.
I don't
think somebody making $15,000 a year should pay as much as somebody making $150,000 a year.
Yeah. Okay.
You don't graduate the tax, make it simple.
I don't disagree with you.
And why do we have that convoluted
that
system? Why do we have that convoluted IRS
Because the
system?
Supreme Court said that,
no, because
that
Democrats
rich people can
and
buy
Republicans,
members of Congress.
Because Democrats and Republicans don't have the courage to stop this abuse in our country.
It's not a matter of courage. They are owned.
Courage to stop being owned. Stop this horrible thing that's happening to American citizens.
Well, here's the thing.
People in jail.
As long as anybody, left, right, in between, it doesn't matter. As long as anybody with enough money and enough commitment to spend that money can come in and buy a congressional race, which is what's happening virtually every district in this country, it's either being bought by Republican interests or Democratic interests. As long as that is the case, this corruption of the United States of America is going to continue.
From both parties.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes. You got another caller we want to
have
yell at me?
Okay.
Love callers.
Okay. Yeah. Here's Chris in Darlington, South Carolina. Hey, Chris, what's up?
Well, you and the sheriff aren't talking about the same thing I called in about.
Well, that's fine. You can change the subject.
Okay. About the rewriting of history by the victors. I mean, the first big rewrite was after the Civil War. And you keep referring to the Boston Tea Party. The first Tea Party was actually in Charleston, South Carolina. But that was removed from all the history books after the Civil War.
Really?
Obviously,
when and where was that?
I think it was about 3 months before the Boston Tea Party.
So it was in the summer of 1773. Was that was it also in opposition to the British East India Company? I'm guessing it pretty much had to be, right?
Yeah, it was. But the Bostonians did it as a copycat event. I mean, if you read current history books, you'd think the entire revolution.
Well, if it's not in any history book, how'd you find it?
That's a good question.
You can still find some old history books published pre-Civil War in some libraries in South Carolina.
Yeah. So how do you know which book to trust?
Yeah. And
you should only trust the books I write
Chris.
Tom Hartman writes. And you can get my books at CSPOA.org.
Okay. Thank you, Chris, for the call. Dan in Tracy City, Tennessee. Hey, Dan, you're on the air.
Hey, thanks for taking my call, Tom.
Sure.
I think it's time that America stood up and took the country back away from the politicians. And the only way I see this happening is to have a nationwide strike. I don't think it's going to happen because the economy is so bad and people.
What would we
so
be
bad.
Striking?
He means like don't go to work.
Don't
you know,
vote.
Shut down the economy.
Oh
yeah,
shut
don't vote. It makes me crazy when people say that.
I won't stop voting.
Yeah. Here's the problem, Dan. You know, if you want to put together a way to subjugate? Yeah, to subjugate a people, strip them economically.
Yeah, because if we went on strike nationwide, that's going to hurt Americans, and not the politicians are going to keep getting their money.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And you know, is starting in 81, really, you know, when we flipped our economic system here in the United States.
But towards his point.
Wages have collapsed.
Yeah. Towards his point.
Yeah.
I'll say this. Why aren't people flocking to the third parties that already exist? We have several third parties in this country, and I can't believe that people aren't flocking to them.
Because people correctly see voting for a third party as shooting themselves in the foot. I mean, I asked the question, you know, back in 2009.
What do you call continuing voting for Republicans and Democrats?
Well, in 2009,
shooting yourself in the heart.
You had some very wealthy people who funded a series of CDs about how to basically show up at your local Republican Party and become a precinct committee person and take over the local party. That went nationwide. These CDs were sent out. There was thousands of them sent all over the country, and that led to the Tea Party takeover. I'm saying the same thing needs to happen in the Democratic Party. We need to get people who are taking over the political parties show up, get inside, and have these parties have some integrity.
Follow the Constitution.
I love less the
government,
idea.
Less spending. Get us out of debt.
Yeah.
And
those are all fine things.
All I've seen the Tea Party. Well, there's some Tea Parties that are just kind of money deals. You know, they're entertainers.
And there are some, particularly in the South, that are.
But I've been to 120 Tea Parties across the country and spoke at all of them, and I just saw people wanting freedom and government to leave them alone.
I wasn't criticizing them. I was saying the Democrats need to learn from them. So but that's, I think, working inside the political parties is where we need to go. 28 minutes past the hour. We'll be back. Thank you. Welcome back. 28 minutes before the hour. Tom Hartman here with you, and Sheriff Richard Mack in the studio with me with CSPOA.org, which you as an individual can join, as well as peace officers. I wanted to bring up a topic with you that we have sort of talked about in the past, but I don't know if you – I'm guessing you probably haven't seen – most people haven't seen this new movie about what's his name, the kid, Ed Snowden, you know, who released all the NSA stuff.
Uh-huh.
And it's a really fascinating movie. It's called Citizen Four, which is how he signed his early stuff to Glenn Greenwald.
I'd actually like to see it. I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah, it's a fascinating movie. And it's mostly him on camera. And when you watch that movie, basically what he says is that the apparatus of a genuinely oppressive state is in place. Mm-hmm. In China, for example, which is an oppressive state, if you say something that the government doesn't like, they don't necessarily or typically, you know, show up and kick your door in. What might happen is you might get an email from some senior official or from a law enforcement officer saying, oh, it's interesting that you said that on the air yesterday, or it's interesting that you said that on a street corner yesterday, or it's interesting that you said that in an email yesterday. Yeah. It's their way of subtly saying, we're watching, look out.
Like there's present government did to Cheryl Atkinson.
Well, Atkinson. I don't know that story well enough to discuss it, but you know,
I've written about it.
Yeah, I'll have to read it. But his point was that the apparatus of state oppression has been put into place largely since 9/11, in the last 15 years, last 12 years, and that we haven't had a president who has basically pulled the trigger. I wrote this book, The Crash of 2016, and I'm standing behind it. I think the stock market's going to fall apart. And one of the points that I make in the book is if you look back at 1932, 1933, that time period, we had FDR in the United States. Germany had Hitler. And we both suffered from the Great Depression.
Yes.
And our people in both countries were saying, damn it, do something. And Hitler built this massive army and this giant state security apparatus and moved in the direction of an oppressive state. Using, by the way, computers from IBM.
And FDR did the New Deal.
Which you may consider an oppressive state. I don't. You know,
It was.
Okay. But the fact of the matter is that we're going to have to make some simple choices. Are we going to become a progressively more authoritarian state day by day? Are we going to use those instruments of state security against whoever seems to get in the way, whether it's me on the left or you on the right, or are we going to start constraining them?
I hope we constrain them, and I hope the American people won't put up with any of this, but I believe that too many people in America are just too dumbed down. They're not involved in the process. They don't even vote. I mean, what is the percentage of Americans that actually vote? Not the ones that are registered. Only about a third of Americans are
10%.
Even registered.
Yeah.
And then the ones that actually vote in America, you're right, 10 to 12, 15%, maybe, if we're lucky.
Yeah.
And so we're a dumbed down society. We're not involved in the freedom process. And the founding fathers, especially Jefferson, said, if the American people are not vigilant, if we're not involved in the process, if you expect to be ignorant and free, you expect what never will be. That is the biggest indictment against the American people. Our politicians are so corrupt and so out of control. I totally agree with you, Tom, that the economy is going to fall. I have said the exact same thing, that this economy will not last 8 years of the Obama administration. It will collapse before he leaves office.
Yeah, I think so, too. And but, you know, probably for different reasons. But I'm
whatever
just looking
it is,
at the structural
it's
stuff.
It's so corrupt, and it can't last.
But the
last.
Question is, what happens when that happens? I mean, this you go back, you talked about our media. You know, we used to have laws, rules, mm-hmm. these god-awful regulations mm-hmm. that said that if you are a rich guy or a big corporation and you want to own a radio station, you can't also own a television station and you can't also own a newspaper. You have to pick. And because we don't want the media of one town
monopolized
to be owned by one voice. Right. Yeah. And Ronald Reagan stopped enforcing that law, the Sherman Antitrust Act in 1982. Mm-hmm. And Bill Clinton signed the Telecommunications Act in 1996, which totally blew that stuff up. And now you've got basically five companies that control over 90% of all the media. You've got 18,000 magazines controlled by 11 companies.
But what would be the problem if you wanted to own all three? And would you really expect government to stop you from owning
yes.
three businesses?
I want that to happen.
See,
yes.
I don't trust government with that. I don't trust them with any of these
jewels. I don't
trust
the guy who owns all the media.
But I don't, okay.
Do you? Do you trust NBC?
Oh.
Do you trust Comcast? Do you trust CBS?
Hell no.
Okay, why do you want them to control
me to turn to government and say, government, you take care of these people.
Richard, George Washington had three horses shot out from underneath him to create government. Government is supposed to be we the people. It's supposed to be us creating the world that we want.
To create government or get rid of oppressive government? He got rid of oppressive government. That's the reason the Revolutionary War was fought. And that's the reason we're in so much trouble today. We have too much government. Jefferson said, all bad government is due to one principle and one principle alone, and that is because we have too much government.
I believe that's a David Barton quote.
$18 trillion in debt to provide us all this wonderful, idiotic, corrupt government.
Yeah.
That's where we're at.
Yeah.
And it cannot continue.
My point is that
economically, I mean that. It will not continue.
No, I don't disagree.
And you're correct.
I don't think that our national debt is going to kill us. I think that our private debt, we've got $54 trillion in private debt right now. And that's a
bomb
waiting
to go off. Well, you mix those two together.
The sovereign debt, the government debt.
And if government debt is no problem, then why do we pay any taxes? Because they can just go in more debt and leave my money alone. Don't take any taxes from any American citizen, especially ones that are poor like me. I could have, 3 years ago, when the housing market really crashed, maybe 4 years ago, I had to pay $8,000 in income tax with me and my wife, federal income tax. Right. I had two sons that lost homes. All they needed was $4,000 each to get their loans caught up and to keep their homes. My government gave money to AIG and GM and Chrysler and would not allow me to keep $8,000.
Right.
To help my sons keep their homes.
This is the story of working Americans all across this country.
Yeah.
And this, you know,
that's no different, no matter if it's a Republican or Democrat in there. I don't get to keep my money, but we'll give that money that I could have given to my sons to keep a home, to keep the American dream.
Then give it to AIG.
Then
if you think there's no difference between the parties, why is it that this piece of legislation that is going to probably pass in 20 minutes in the mm-hmm. House of Representatives that says that it was literally written by a Citigroup lobbyist that says that these guys can gamble in the derivatives market with depositor funds, with our money, without our permission or knowledge. And if it crashes, the government, we the people, will bail it out.
Yeah.
And, you know, why
that's
is
absurd.
It that is exclusively,
that's absurd.
It's exclusively
it is
promoted by the Republican Party?
It's supported by both parties.
No,
let's
it's not.
Get real.
There are no Democrats who support this.
This legislation, they've done it in the past. Who's done all the bailouts? The bailouts are no different.
The setup for the crash happened in 1999 and 2000 during the Clinton administration. Yeah. Bill Clinton signed Gramm-Leach-Bliley. Bill Clinton signed the Commodity Futures Modernization Act. You're right.
Both parties
they were promoted.
Cater to the money corporations.
But I would submit to you that the Democratic Party, or at least some people inside the Democratic Party, at least the Progressive Caucus, are waking up to this. No, they're not.
They're just opposing the Republicans.
No, they're opposing the banks.
Too much. The Patriot Act, it was supported by Republicans. Okay, then it got supported by Obama, and it got reinstated by the Democrats.
Right, it's a disaster.
And the Democrats were assailing the Republicans for doing that because it was so unconstitutional. Both parties do it. Why do we have $18 trillion debt? Because both Democrats and Republicans did it and still do it. Why do we have an out-of-control criminal IRS? Because both parties allow it. Why do we have the EPA out there destroying property rights of citizens? Why do we have them destroying jobs, economy? Why do we have a president of the United States who now is offering amnesty? Who's amnesty going to hurt? Will it help ghettos? Will it help black children looking for jobs? Will it help teenagers looking for jobs in poverty-stricken areas of America?
Actually, it could.
It will never help them.
No, it could, because when you no longer have an illegal workforce, what the illegal workforce does is it creates a floor below the floor.
Those 5 million people are going to be vying for the same jobs, whether we like it or not.
But they will be paid at least a minimum wage, rather than being paid $2 an hour.
Oh, and the government enforced minimum wage on businesses.
Absolutely.
That they have no business to tell me how to run my business.
They absolutely do.
They have never. First of all,
we've got to change our language here. The government is we, not they.
No, because we already talked about that. 12% of the people vote. They do not represent the American people. Okay. In fact, right now, if we have a real democracy and Obama wants to do the will of the people, then he would get rid of Obamacare because 65% of the people don't want it. 68% of the people say we're going the wrong direction.
Yeah. When you ask people if they want insurance companies to be able to kick people off their policies when they get cancer, do you want to go back to that?
No, I don't want any of that.
So you want the government to regulate insurance companies?
No, I don't want the government
to
tell
me. So you do want the insurance companies to be able to kick you off your policy?
I don't want government running my life and telling me how to live.
When your insurance company says, Richard, sorry, you've got cancer, heart disease, we're not going
to
pay for
it. I can go to an insurance company and say, look, I want a contract that says that I keep my insurance.
And they'll tell you to screw yourself.
Then they're not going to get very much business, and it'll be a business opportunity.
And you get sick and you're going to die.
No, no.
Who are you going to turn to, Richard?
Because one, I turn
Who's
to my family.
Who's going to defend you?
Two, I pay my own bills now, and I'm not wealthy.
I pay my own doctor bills.
I do not have insurance.
And
I'm not taking Obamacare because I'm an American citizen, and I don't have to. And this president is not going to force me to buy a product from an insurance company that we already know are all corrupt anyway. And so I'm not going to say, bow down to a king who says, you better go buy a product that I say you have to buy.
Would you go with the Canadian system?
No, theirs is worse than ours.
But they have better outcomes than we do.
Our system was better. Our system was better before Obamacare. Our system was better.
So back when insurance companies could kick people off their policies, that was a good thing.
Go to a different insurance company when you first buy it. And when my employer, my employer,
you're right, they're all criminals.
You're absolutely
right. We'll be back with Sheriff Richard Mack. Stick around.
You're listening to Tom Hartman. Visit TomHartman.com for audio and video archives.
It's the Constitutional Sheriffs and Peace Officers Association, CSPOA.org. Sheriff Mack is here in town with. We'll be back.